The next point is provident funds. I already told you the meaning of provident fund. What is provident fund? Okay, now let us start with the different types of it. Statutory means compulsory, employers will have to contribute to some portion in their employees' provident funds accounts. Next, we have recognized provident funds, unrecognized provident funds, and we have superannuation also, but here we need to understand only these three types. Okay, सबसे पहले देखो यहाँ पे meaning दी हुई है. The meaning is given for statutory provident fund. It is maintained by government employees. Okay, it is maintained for government employees. Recognized, it is maintained recognized by commissioner of income tax, because it is, the name itself says no, recognized. So it is recognized by commissioner of income tax. So any company who gives the service of recognized provident fund, that means it is recognized by commissioner of income tax. Okay, unrecognized means neither statutory nor recognized, therefore it is categorized into different you can say sector section, which is known as unrecognized provident fund. Okay, now let us see what is taxable, what all is not taxable. There is a printing mistake I see here, and this is a picture that I have posted here. It is not that I have written. It should be employer's contribution. Wait, I'll tell you. So look here, it is correctly given here. See, one by one we will discuss. SPF is also given here, huh? Superannuation fund. So statutory provident fund, if there is an employer's contribution, see, some portion of your salary will be deducted and will be transferred to provident fund. Anyways, it's your salary, no? Anyways, you are going to get it in the future. So that is not an extra income for you. It is only a part of salary. Provident fund, it is a part of salary only. It is deducted from salary, in fact. It is not added in the salary. It is always deducted from the salary. What I am talking about is the portion of your salary which is contributed to towards your account of provident fund. Okay, that is not income for you. What is income for you is employer's contribution. What is extra income for you? Extra will be over and above your contribution. More than your contribution, if employers is also contributing for you, it will become income for you. It will become extra income for you. Okay, so that income is exempted. See, employer's contribution to such fund is not treated as an income of the employee. That means if it is exempted, employer's contribution, whatever employer's contribution will come in the hands of, will be received in the hands of employee, it will not be taxable. It will be completely exempted. Interest. Now, because it is a PF account, no, just like you have a saving bank account, we have a PF account. Employees have PF account. So PF account, there is an interest that is received by you. Through PF account, you receive interest. So interest is also exempted in the hands of employees. See? Okay? Now, amount received at the time of termination, when you leave the job, when you are terminated from the job, when you retire from the job, you get lump sum amount. That lump sum amount is also exempted in the hands of employees. Now, what provident fund I'm talking about? I'm talking about statutory provident fund. Only statutory, everything is exempted. Employer's contribution is exempted. Interest also exempted. Termination ke time pe the lump sum amount which is received by employees also exempted. Okay, this is about statutory provident fund. Let me come to recognized provident fund. Very, very, very important. Note it down somewhere. I mean, this point will definitely, it will come in the question. It is very important. Recognized provident fund. Now look, see, first of all, employees' own contribution, mera khud ka, मैं एम्प्लॉई, मेरी सैलरी में से कुछ डिडक्ट होके मेरे ही आरपीएफ में जा रहा है. फ्रॉम माय सैलरी, द डिडक्शन फ्रॉम माय सैलरी, इट इज ट्रांसफर्ड टू माय प्रोविडेंट फंड अकाउंट. इट इज नॉट एन इनकम फॉर मी फर्स्ट ऑफ ऑल, बिकॉज इट इज डिडक्टेड फ्रॉम माय ओन सैलरी. हाउ इट विल बी माय इनकम? नो, इट विल नॉट बी माय इनकम. यस, इफ आई अर्नड सम इंटरेस्ट ऑन माय personal provident fund account, I mean not personal, it should be recognized provident fund account. So if I earn some interest, that would be my income. If employers contribute for me, that would be my income. My own contribution, how it would be income for me? Okay, salary would be income for me. From salary only, you are transferring a part of salary to another account which is known as RPF, Recognized Provident Fund. Is it known as a different income, separate income? No. It is a part of salary. In fact, it is deducted from salary. I'm talking about employees' own contribution. It is not an income at all. In fact, it is deducted, not added. Okay. Now, let me come to the next point. Employer's contribution. That means if your boss, if your employer also contributes for your benefit into your account, this is your account. Recognized Provident Fund is your account maintained by the employers, maintained by your employer. Now, if such is the case, if such is the case, RPF is the case, and if employer is also contributing some portion for you, then he may contribute any amount of portion, but 12% of that is exempted. Above that will be taxable. Ma'am, 12% kiska? Salary. 12% of salary will be exempted. Will not be treated as income. 12% of salary will not be treated as income. That means it is exempted. Above 12%, if he is contributing 18%, if your employer is contributing 18%, then up to 12% is exempted. Salary ka 12%. Salary is 12%. Exempted. Rest of 6% will be taxable. Because employer has, by his own wish, he has contributed 18%. He's a very good employer. He wants to contribute more and more for the welfare of the employees, for the future benefit of the employees. Therefore, he opted 18%. He can give any amount. It's his wish. But as per the rules, only 12% will be exempted. Okay. Did you understand
such
point? Okay. Now, if suppose, why suppose, actually, when employers contribute, you receive interest. When your own contribution is done from your own salary, the interest is received. Yes. I'm talking about both the interest, employer's contribution interest, and interest from own contribution, my own contribution. Interest will be received, and that interest is my income. Yes, that interest has to be treated as an income because it is an extra that I earn from that particular provident fund, RPF account. Okay, that interest may come up to any amount. I may receive it up to any amount, but 9.5%, up to 9.5% is exempted in the hands of employees. How much is exempted?
9.5%.
Suppose you have received 10% of interest. 10% of interest. How much is exempted?
1.5.
How much is exempted?
9.5.
Yes. And how much is taxable?
0.5.
Yes. Correct. If you received 10% interest, 9.5 is exempted. No. So 0.5% will be taxable. Simple. Interest. So I hope you understood what percentage of interest is exempted? 9.5. Okay. If the lump sum amount is received, if the certain conditions are satisfied, then the lump sum amount will be received I mean, then the lump sum amount received from such fund at the time of termination is exempted in the hands of employees. Okay, so this, I think ये नहीं पूछा जाता है amount received at the time of termination, आपके समझने के लिए दिया हुआ है. क्या पूछा जाएगा? Employer's contribution and interest. ठीक है, अब इसी ने ना यहाँ पे ये भी बताया है, सैलरी फ्रॉम दिस पर्पस विल इंक्लूड. अब हम बोल रहे हैं ना यहाँ पे, देखो 12% ऑफ सैलरी ऐसा बोल रहे हैं ना, है ना, यहाँ पे हम कह रहे हैं, देखो यहाँ पे लिखा हुआ है 12% ऑफ सैलरी. तो व्हाट ऑल हैज टू बी काउंटेड इन सैलरी? सैलरी फॉर दिस पर्पस मींस फॉर रिकॉग्नाइज्ड अनरिकॉग्नाइज्ड पब्लिक प्रोविडेंट फंड, व्हाट एवर प्रोविडेंट फंड्स वी आर डूइंग फॉर दिस पर्पस, सैलरी हैज टू बी टेकन इन टू कंसिडरेशन. And in salary, what all things has to be considered with the salary? With salary, you have to include dearness allowances, commission if it is paid on fixed percentage. Okay, so dearness allowances and commission, both you have to take consideration into with salary. Next, we have unrecognized provident fund. Okay, let's see. Employer's contribution is not taxable, that means it is exempted. Interest fully exempted. Okay, amount received at the time of termination, okay, if you want to see you can check here, see note number 3, he says no, check note number 3, see note number 3. So this is note number 3. So what he says is when you receive the lump sum amount of URPF, unrecognized provident fund, at the time of termination, see, it will not be asked in the question paper, but you should, it should be in your knowledge. That's why I'm sharing it with you. Okay, so employee's contribution is not chargeable to tax. Okay, the lump sum amount that I will receive from my own contribution, employee's own contribution, will not be chargeable to tax, exempted. Interest on employee's contribution is taxed. Yes, interest will be taxed, but where? Income from other sources. Last heading. Okay, let's come to employer's contribution. It is employees. This is employers. Employer's contribution and interest thereon, both are taxable in the name of salary, in the heading of salary income. Okay.
Yes, ma'am.
So it is about a lump sum amount received, but this will not be asked. Yes, of course. But if a short note comes, write a short note on provident funds. So you will have to explain each one of them. No, first statutory provident fund, then recognized provident fund, then URPF, then PPF, public provident fund. So you will have to answer in the form of short note. There you need to write these points. Otherwise, in the question, practical question, employer's contribution and interest thereon will be asked. Okay, let's come to PPF. PPF is very simple. Employer's contribution, fully exempted. Interest, fully exempted. See, it is written, no? Amount received at the time of termination, fully exempted. Everything is fully exempted. So, see how easy it is to learn. Statutory provident fund, everything is exempted. Can you see? Everything is exempted. Employers,
yes,
contribution,
ma'am.
Interest, amount received at the time of termination. So simple. All three things are exempted. Okay. PPF, all three things are exempted. So you can learn together. Statutory provident fund, SPF, and public provident fund, PPF. Everything is exempted. Recognized provident fund, if it is employee's contribution, 12% of salary, up to 12% is exempted. Up to 12% of salary is exempted. Up over and above 12%, it will be taxable. Interest, up to 9.5% is exempted. Over and above 9.5, it will be taxable. Okay. And next, URPF, employer's contribution, not exempted. Interest, exempted. And URPF ke note pe kya likha hua tha? Ke employees ka contribution jo hota hai, lump sum amount jo bhi milega, to not taxable. Interest, taxable in the head of income from other sources. And employer's contribution and interest thereon, both are taxable. I'm talking about lump sum amount received after retirement or termination. So employer's contribution and interest thereon will be taxable in the head of salary. Okay. That's it. This is what I wanted to explain you with the help of this slide. So I will replace this table, don't worry, because here a printing mistake is there. See, employee's contribution, it is not an income, first of all. It is not an income, it is just a saving that you are doing in a different account. Taking out from salary account, putting it into the another account, PF account. It is not an income, it is just a transfer from one account to the another account. Employee's own contribution is never an income. Employer's contribution is an income for employee. So here it is a printing mistake, I know. And I've taken it from somewhere else. I did not note this point. So, okay, no problem. I will replace this table and I will then share it with you. Okay, anyways, I have not shared it. So I will share it with you, don't worry. Next, house rent allowances. See, these conditions are given. You don't have to learn these conditions at all. This is in the post-graduation that they have to do. Okay, so far if you want to understand, you can read out. If you have any doubt, you can ask me. But for now, the exemption limit of HRA will always be given to you. Example, suppose. First, let me clear what is HRA. HRA means house rent allowances. Suppose you are working in Infosys company and you don't have your own house. You are living in a rented house. As of now, you are living in a rented house and you are working in Infosys company. So Infosys has a policy that every employee's rent, house rent will be reimbursed to them. I mean, the employer is there and he will be ready to pay your rent, house rent. And that is your perquisite, that is allowances for you. Allowances means perquisites, benefits that you receive from your employer. So when employer will pay rent on behalf of you, it is your house rent. But you are not paying that rent. Who is paying that rent? Or who is...
Company.
Yes, company is paying that rent. That becomes my house rent allowances. Or example, let me give you the another example. Suppose you are paying 20,000 rent every month. Which rent? House rent. Suppose you are paying every month 20,000 rent. House rent. And after completion of 1 year, you, how much did you pay for full year? If 1 month rent is 20,000, how much it becomes for 12 months? 2,40,000. Do you agree?
Yes, ma'am.
Okay. Yes, ma'am. So 2,40,000 then at the end of the year will be reimbursed by the employer to the employees. Employer will reimburse you. Reimburse means first you pay, I will pay back to you later on. Are you getting my point? But now this is not the case of office expenses. No. Leave travel allowances. You remember yesterday's point. It was related to office allowances. You are spending the amount for office purpose and you are receiving it back. That reimbursement is not an income. But here it is an income. How? Here it is an allowances treated as an perquisite, treated as an income. How? Because it is your own personal expense, personal kharcha. Personal expenses, eh? Who should be paying personal expenses? Me. I should be paying. We should be paying our personal expenses, but our personal expenses are borne by our employers. So it is for me that I am doing. And employer is also doing it for me. So it is my benefit, no? So house rent allowances is my income. It is exempted, but the exemption limits are there. See, three conditions are there. The lowest will be, the least will be selected. See, can you see the word that I have highlighted, the least word?
Yes, ma'am. Yes.
The least of all the three, three conditions are there. Amounts to be calculated. And the three amounts will be there. Least will have to be picked up and the exemption will be given. But here you don't have to read and learn about these three conditions. In exam or in the question paper, house rent allowances related exemptions will be already available to you. Example, suppose you received from your employer house rent allowances 80,000 rupees in a year. ब्रैकेट में लिखा हुआ रहेगा, इन द ब्रैकेट इट विल बी गिवन एज 24,000 इज एग्जम्प्टेड. हाउ मच इज एग्जम्प्टेड?
24,000
ऑलरेडी गिवन, यू डोंट नीड टू फाइंड, ऑलरेडी गिवन इन द क्वेश्चन. सो 80,000 यू रिसीव्ड, आउट ऑफ 80,000 24,000 इज एग्जम्प्टेड, देयरफॉर व्हाट अमाउंट विल बी टैक्सेबल? 50? आपको ये कंडीशन याद करने की जरूरत नहीं है. ओके, नाउ लेट मी कम टू लास्ट पार्ट ऑफ द एग्जम्प्टेड सैलरी इनकम्स, दैट इज स्पेशल अलाउंसेस, सेक्शन 14, 10, सॉरी सेक्शन 10 subsection 14. HRA was section 10 subsection 13A. Section 10 subsection 13A. Special allowances. Now it is not given to every employee. Few employees receive such type of allowances which are listed here. Now let us see one by one. There is a list of special allowances. Okay, so let us see one by one. Total how many are there? 16. We will see one by one. Okay, first, conveyance allowances, special allowances, traveling allowances. We have done it earlier also. Conveyance allowances, travel allowances. Yaad hai? What was the formula? Amount received minus amount spent is equals to taxable. Amount spent is exempted. Amount spent is nothing but exempted amount. Therefore, they have replaced the word spent with exempted. Why? Because the amount spent is exempted. So how much is exempted? The amount spent is exempted. Suppose you have received from your employer 5,000 rupees in the name of conveyance allowances. Conveyance, traveling from one place to another is conveyance allowances. So you have received 5,000 per month. And exempted is 2,500. So taxable will be 2,500. And amount of exemption is amount spent. So if you receive 5,000 from your employer and you spend rupees 2,500, so 2,500 will be exempted. No. And the rest of the amount will be taxable. So yes, exemption is given, but not completely. The amount spent is exempted. That's it. Next, CCA, city compensatory allowances. Fully taxable hote hain ye. It is fully taxable. Remember, it is a special allowance given to special category of employees, and it is fully taxable in their hands. It is not exempted. No amount is exempted. Fully taxable. Dearness allowances. It is fully taxable. High cost of living allowances, fully taxable. Children education allowances, very important, very, very. Children education allowances, if your boss gives you some portion of money in the name of, he's contributing you in the name of educational allowances. He's contributing to you for your children's education allowances. Then, exempted up to 100 per month per child. One child, 100 per month into 1200 rupees. So one child, 1200 rupees per annum. If you get it for two children, then 2400 rupees exempted. How 2400? Because 100 per month, no? Per yes, child. So 100 into 12 becomes 1200. 1200 into one child, matlab 1200. So for two child into two means 2400. Okay, and the ceiling limit is maximum two children. Here it is not written, but I'm telling you, the maximum limit of exemption will be given to you up to two children. If you have three children, then it is 2400 plus 12. See, 1200, 1200, 1200. Three times, no? So what is 1200? Three times of 1200. 3600. 3600 is there that you have received from your employer for three children. But exemption amount will be 1200 only. Oh, sorry, 2400 only. Why? Because maximum two children, up to maximum two children, exemption will be given. And 2400, how did we calculate 2400? I hope you understand. 100 per month, yes, per child. One child, 100 per month means 1200 for one child. 1200 for another child becomes 2400. 1200 for another child becomes, third child becomes 3600. So you may receive for n number of children the educational allowances from your employer for n number of children. But exemption will be given up to two children only. It is not written here, but please note it down somewhere. Okay, next. Children's hostel expenditure allowances. Now, just like it was educational allowances, it now replaced the word educational with hostel. Now, if it is hostel, then 100, instead of 100 per month, it will be 300 per month. Everything else is same. 100 per month, replace it with 300 per month. And how we will calculate taxable amount? Very simple. Whatever is received minus whatever is exempted will be taxable. Suppose I received for three children, 300 per month. So 300 into 12 means 3,600. 3,600 for three children. For one child, 3,600. Okay, 3,600 for one child. Okay, so how much it would become for three children? 3600 plus 3600 plus 3600. How much it comes to?
10,800.
Very good. 10,800 is received amount. The amount that you have received from employer for three children in the name of children's hostel expenditure allowances. But how much is exempted up to two children? Means 3,600 plus 3,600, which is 7,200. Yes. So 10,800 is received. Out of 10,800, 7,200 will be exempted up to two children. And what amount will be taxable?
3,600.
Yes.
The remaining
amount will be taxable. Because maximum two children, this is the point, very important, bracket, maximum two children, exempted up to maximum two children. And for one child, it is 300 per month. If you want to calculate for two children, then 300 per month, that means into 12, for two child, you have to multiply that with two. Okay, leave travel allowances, we have already done. Actual expenses will be exempted. Okay. Or an air economy fare, which is whichever assistance is less, is exempted. Whatever amount is spent by you will be exempted. We have already done this point yesterday. Fixed medical allowances. If company pays you medical allowances, then fully taxable. Uniform or washing allowances, exempted to the extent of spent. That means same. You have received 5,000, you have spent 3,000. So 3,000 will be exempted from 5,000 and taxable will be 2,000. Same. Tiffin or lunch allowances, free lunch facilities given to employees, fully taxable. Project allowances, fully taxable. Servant or pune allowances, fully taxable. Wardenship allowances, fully taxable. Shift allowances, different shifts. You receive night shift ka aapko extra milta hai compensation. So it is fully taxable. Daily allowances, helper allowances, researcher allowances. If you are doing a research on something in the name, with the name of your company. Okay, so it is exempted to the extent of amount spent. That means the amount spent will be exempted. Same formula, received minus exempted is equals to taxable. Same. Last, transport. Now this transport you don't have to learn from here. No, don't do it from here. 1 minute. So यहाँ से नहीं पढ़ना है. Transport allowances you don't have to study from here. It is old information. It is not wrong, but it is not applicable now. What is applicable now is given here. Look here. Recent changes in transport allowances. Transport means traveling from office to home. And if you receive some allowances, monetary allowances, that is known as transport allowances. Now see, transport allowances for commuting. Commuting means moving from one place to another. So commuting from the place of residence where you live to the place of duty, the place where you have a job. So 1600 per month is exempted. How much is exempted? 1600 per month. So multiply 1600 with 12 months. So for per annum it becomes 19,200. Check.
Yes, ma'am.
19,200 per annum and 1600 per month. One and the same thing. Please don't try to, confuse yourself. Don't confuse. Don't get confused with two different amounts. No, it is one and the same thing. One is given monthly and another is given annually. So 1600 per month, 19,200 per annum. Now, it is for normal citizen. If a person is handicapped, then look at this point. Transport allowances for commuting from place of residence to the place of duty for an employee who is physically challenged, such as blind, deaf. Blind means cannot see. Deaf means cannot hear. Dumb means cannot speak. Or orthopedically handicapped. Matlab, like few parts of body, like hands, legs. Agar nahi hai to. Aisa hota na, aapne dekha hoga, kisi ko pair nahi hote, kisi ko haath nahi hote. So orthopedically wo handicapped hai. With the disability of lower extremities. Matlab thoda disable bhi hai wo. ठीक है, थोड़ा डिसेबल है वो, पैर नहीं है, हाथ नहीं है और चल फिर नहीं सकता है, थोड़ा बहुत लोअर एक्सट्रीमिटी, इतना ज्यादा सीवियर नहीं, नॉट टू मच, नॉट सीवियरली हैंडीकैप, बट यस ही इज हैंडीकैप. सो फॉर सच लाइक पर्संस इट इज 3200 पर मंथ, डबल ऑफ 1600, 3200 पर मंथ. एंड इफ यू कन्वर्ट 3200 इनटू एन एनम per annum, it will be 38,400. Is it okay?
Yes, ma'am.
The transport, you have to do in the transport allowances, you have to do this much only. So this part we can do it tomorrow because I have another lecture also. So we will do this part tomorrow and we will start